Hello, good morning everyone. I'm Aditya from Young Innovators. As you know, we are from Young Innovator Educational Services Private Limited. We are expertise in astronomy, robotics and aeromodeling. So we do conduct regular astronomy courses in many schools and a workshop also throughout the Karnataka. Okay, we set a world record in assembling 100 telescope by students in one session, at one place. Okay, then so today we are here for astronomy session. So astronomy at home, finding a true north. So similarly, like astronomy, we have a robotics, aero modeling, and astronomy online classes. So you can aero modeling classes can be telecasted in our channel by 10 o'clock, and astronomy classes by 11:30. And robotics class can be streamed after 4 o'clock. Okay, so coming to our class, astronomy at home. So today's session is about finding true north. So there'll be it's a 5-day session, 5-day course. So first day is about, day one is about finding true north. Day two is about solar projection method. Day three about altitude of Venus. Day four about phases of moon. And day five about finding a time using star. Okay, so before starting to our actual topic, so what is astronomy? Astronomy. Astro means star. Nomi means study. So astronomy is a study of star. So is it only study of star? No. Actually, so astronomy is a branch of science which deals with the study of celestial objects, space, physical universe as a whole. Celestial objects means, what are the celestial objects? Celestial object can be a star, can be a moon, can be a planet, galaxy, black hole, neutron stars, so much. The celestial, all will come under the celestial objects. Studying of a celestial object becomes an astronomy. So one of the interesting part is, how is this astronomy started? So when it started and how it started? So the oldest record of astronomy will trace back to about 5,000 year old. That's called Stonehenge. Okay, and how it started? So we can say it's when humans consciously started to observe the night sky. That's how we started. So you can see in the top left corner, it's a Stonehenge. It's in England. It belongs to one of the island of England. It's one of the oldest astronomical monument. It's 5,000 year old. Okay, astronomy was started even before. Okay, so since we have this, means it was started even before. But this is the oldest record what we have. So this was built in about 3000 BC, and it's built with heavy stones. The heaviest stones weighed about 22 tons here. How they lift it and they brought it here, we don't know actually. So why they're using it for? They're using it for seasonal changes and to observe the predict the seasons. So seasons are indirectly depend for agriculture and much more things. And the next one, it's about one of the painting found in China. So it's the time of this, the when they drawn it, traced back to around 1054 BC. So the scientists have decrypted that it was there was a supernova event. Someone saw it and they drew it. So this was a supernova event, and this was a moon phase during that time. Okay, and then the astronomy developed. Galileo used the telescope for astronomical purpose, and much more other civilizations started to predict something using the star patterns. And so we Indians, we are not also lagged behind. So we built something called sundials. Using that, time also can be measured precisely. So this is the Jantar Mantar. You can find it in Jaipur. Okay, so going back a bit, so why the astronomy was important in olden days? So astronomy was very important because, you know, we didn't have any calendar system or a time. So we didn't have any clock, or we didn't have anything to predict something like for agriculture. The time is very important. Time in the sense of months, like a part of year, seasons especially. So when we have to plant something, when we have to harvest something. It's all depend on the seasons. In order to predict the seasons, so they didn't have any reference. So the only reference what they had is also only star patterns. Since Earth revolves around the Sun, so we see a different star pattern at the different time of a year. Okay. So based on, by just keeping the reference, for example, you can see Orion constellation here. Orion can be seen in the night sky prominently during the winter. So if you are able to see the winter at the night about our head above, we can say it's end of the winter and starting of summer actually. Okay. So like that, using star patterns, we could able to predict the seasons. So seasons will indirectly help for our agriculture. And this calendar system, time system, everything. And one more part was a direction. So in a daytime, think about the cavemen. So they're not staying at one place. They're moving. They're moving for food, for everything. They had to change their places. Okay. So they didn't have a house like us. They have only caves. So in order to, from if you are, if you want anything, like if you go for hunting or something, harvesting some food, so again go back to home. So during that, what reference they can use? They can use surrounding places, trees or some rocks as a marker, and they can come back to the place. But what if it was night? So they can't see anything. So how to get the directions? So how to get the direction to come back home? So only thing in a night time what we can help is stars. So again, stars, using stars, you can actually find the directions. So where stars are rising, we can consider as the east, and where setting is the west, and so perpendicular to that plane is a north and south. So directions are, so using astronomy as a star patterns, you can actually find out the directions. So directions are four major directions we have: east, west, north and south. So in a night time, you can, using a star pattern, where it rises and where it sets, you can actually find out these directions. But so you have to wait along. So in order to move that, these star patterns move are about 15 degrees in a 1 hour. So if you have waited 1 hour, you can actually notice that movement. So if you are constantly seeing it, that a movement is very less, you won't be able to notice it. Okay. So in these four directions, east, west, north and south. So in a daytime, so where sun rises, that's east, and where sun sets, it's a west. Perpendicular to that line, it's a north and south. Okay. So in a morning, if sun is rising, yes, you can say it's a east. If sun is setting, you can say it's a west. Okay, in a morning, same, if you face the east, your left side is a north and your right side is a south. Now, during evening, when you face west, your right side is north and your left side is south. So here, you can see, visualize those things. Yes, and if you draw a line from south to north, or between these two poles, that line is called meridian. So if sun crosses this point, it's called second half, it's a morning and an afternoon. So it's nearly around 12 o'clock, it will cross that point and it will be in the western sky. So this is the east part and west part. The line which divides east and west part is called meridian. Okay. So if you're able to find one of the directions, let's say if you find east, then you can get all the other directions. Or if you get a west, you can get all the directions. Or if you get able to find one direction, you can trace back all other directions. So how to find true north? Like for example, in the morning you have a sun is in east, and in the evening we'll have it in west. What about in between time? In between time, you're not able to trace back the other any directions. So okay. So for example, north. How to find north? So one more word you can see, it's a true north I mentioned. What is true north then? So actual north, true north or actual north, geographical, in other words, geographical north or a celestial north, means where the our rotation axis is passed through. So you know Earth is rotating, so where the rotation axis passed through, it's called poles. So top one is a north and this is south. Now North Pole is located in an Arctic Ocean, so you can see this is the North Pole. So how to find this North Pole? As you know, it's using a compass. Yes, it's a general answer. But so how compass actually shows, it's because, so we know inside Earth we have a molten metals. So because of this motion, the outside outer core, we have a molten metals. Because of rotation, Earth actually generates a magnetic field. The Earth can be imagined as one of giant magnet. Compass always will, like a magnet will always, opposite pole will attract. So when you hold a magnet, it will point towards the pole. So our north pole of our compass will show about the actual south, which is a north pole is actual magnetic north what we have. Sorry, magnetic south we have inside. So it will point towards us, that one. So that's how we can actually find the north. That's what your mobile will do or a normal compass will do. It will point towards the magnetic north. But actually, magnetic north is not actually exactly aligned to our geographical north. So here you can see. Okay. So here you can see. So this is the rotation axis, which is actual north pole or a true north pole. Or a magnetic north pole is little bit away. It's around 500 kilometers away. This is located in Canada, Arctic Canada region. So it's located there. So what your magnet or a compass or a mobile can show this point, not the actual geographical north. So it's little bit away from here also, you can see it's a little bit away from the geographical north. Then how we can actually find out the true north? So for a day-to-day life, say your true north or a magnetic north, it doesn't affect so much. If you are doing a daily life, it's not going to affect. For if you are doing any scientific measurements, for example, you have a telescope and tracking any celestial object, or any scientific daytime, if you are measuring a scientific daytime scientific measurements, or a precise, if you are measuring a precise time using a sundial, so aligning that into a true north matters a lot. That's what gives the actual answers. So how we can find the true north? So you can see in the sky, you just need a one simple stick. So you just have to observe the shadow of it. Okay, how to do that? Let's see. So we know Earth is rotating. Because of rotation, Sun appears to move from it appears to rise from east and appears to set in the west. So actually, Earth is rotating from west to east. That's why for us, Sun appears to be moving. Actually, Sun is not moving. Earth is rotating. Because of that, we see an apparent motion. So because of apparent sun's motion, we can see a shadow length is varying and a shadow direction also. So okay, see here also you can see when it's rising, the shadow will be towards west. When it will be our head above, it will be very least. And when it's about setting, the shadow will be towards east. So it's in the opposite direction of sun's motion. So this observation of a shadow actually give rise to help us to find a true north. How? Okay, right. See here. So you know sun moves from east to west. So that is our plane. So east to west plane. So if you draw exact perpendicular to that plane, it's for north and south. So in that's how you can get the north and south. How to find exact north? Yes, we can do this. So we have an activity for it. So for this activity, you need a simple one stick. So at least about 1 foot is better. So if you have more lengthier that, so it will be even better actually. If you don't have a stick, you can place any simple bottle. So simple bottle, if it has a top, like a sharp top, that will be even more better for a precise marking. Okay. So place it in a flat surface and make sure that it's exactly perpendicular to the surface. It's not tilted any direction. If it is, make sure it's exactly perpendicular to the surface. And start observing its shadows. I suggest better start by 11 o'clock. So mark its shadow. For each 20 minutes, mark its shadow. Start marking shadow. So for a precise measure, for each 10 minutes, may start marking the shadow. Okay. So around 11 o'clock to start from around 11 o'clock and do it till around 1:30, 2 o'clock. So you can observe that shadow length and its direction will be varying. As you can see in the slides, okay, when it's in a rising in the east, the shadow was towards west, and when it comes head above, the shadow was a very least, and when it started to towards west, and the shadow, you can see shadow moved towards east. So what you have to observe here, so when you mark this shadow, so look for a shortest shadow when we have the shortest shadow, mark that point. And draw a line from, So draw a line from the its base to the shortest shadow. That is actually pointing towards the north. That's how you can find a true north. You can place a compass there and see how much difference we have for it. So that's what you can able to, that's how you can find out the true north. So here also you can see extended line from here is actually pointing towards north. So how this works? It's because it's earth rotation and a sun moving from, we know sun moving from east to west. So at when it is in a zenith or a topmost in our head above, so that time it will be, it can cast a shortest shadow. So this will point towards north. So one more important, it's always this shortest shadow point towards north, is it? Not actually, yes. So we, in a, for a Bangalore, for about, you know, after August 18 towards south. So make sure that in this duration, if you do the experiment, that will be pointing towards south. Why is that? Yes, we'll come. So if we are in an equator, we don't have much problems. But since we are in a above the equator, we are in 13 degree latitude. Our Bangalore's latitude is 13 degree. So for us, sun's is actually a bit tilted on Earth's position. Why it's tilted? It's because, so one thing is for, we are, our position on a Earth, on a globe, we are about 13 degree height. That's why this pattern itself is tilted. And you can see some in a summer solstice, June 21st, March 21st and September 24th, it moves here. Those are called equinox days. So in a March 21st and a September 24th is the only 2 days sun exactly rises in the east. Why is that change? It's because we know Earth is tilted. It's tilted. So sun, we have a sun here. So it's tilted Earth. When it's revolved around the sun, so tilt with respect to the sun is varying. So when it's here, this is called summer solstice. So it's in summer solstice for a northern hemisphere. It happens in June 24th. So sunlight will, direct sunlight will hit towards the northern part. So just it will be more towards, sun position will be more towards northern in a June 21st. So when it's here, when it's here or here, these two are called equinox part. During those days, sun exactly rises east. That's in a March 21st and to September 24th. During those days, sun exactly rises in these 2 points. When it is here, it's called solstice, winter solstice. Winter solstice for northern hemisphere. These seasons are actually opposite for others, our sun. Okay. So, which part actually?
Two slides from
this. From two slides from this. Okay. So, looks like someone want to just repeat this part. So, in order to find true north, so you know Earth is rotating because of sun appears to be moving. That's called apparent motion of sun. So when sun appears to be moving, and the shadow, that shadow direction also appears to be moving. So in order to find true north, you have a very simple experiment. So you just have to, you just need a simple stick, any simple stick, actually it's more than, I suggest more than 1 foot, or you have any flat bottle, something like that, which has a top, sharp top edge. Okay, so start observing its shadow and mark its position on the floor, or anything, if you can keep any sheet on below it, and start marking it the shadow. Okay, so I suggest start by 11 o'clock. So from 11 o'clock, each 10 minutes, start marking its shadow positions. So when you're done, like after 11 to around 1:30, 2 o'clock, start mark these shadow points. So when you're done, you'll have the shadow points. Look for a shortest one, shortest from the base of the your stick, or your when you, if you keep and kept any bottle. The shortest shadow will be pointing towards north. Okay, that's how you can actually find it. But this experiment, the shortest shadow will point towards, not always point towards. So it depends on where we are living on Earth. So for example, if you are above the 23 degree latitude, means like near the, it's you are above the around 23 degree, around near Delhi, I think. So if you are above it, it's always your shortest shadow, it will be pointing to north. But if you are below it, so in a tropic region, this will be changing. So since we are in a Bangalore 13 degree region, so this point will point towards north in between August 18 to March 24, what you can see, sorry, not March 24, it's April 24. Sorry, my mistake. So, August 18 to April 24, what you can see is it will be towards, always towards north. In between April 24th to August 18th, this shortest shadow will be pointing towards south. It's, why is that? Because I'm going to explain. That's what. So always shortest shadow won't point towards north. So for us, it's between, for the people who are living in Bangalore, it's between August 18 to April 24th. This shortest shadow will point toward north. In during the April 24th to August 18th, means now if you do it, the experiment, the shortest shadow will be pointing towards south. Why is that? Because so earth is tilted. So when earth is tilted, so because direct sunlight won't actually fall on an equator. So celestial equator for us, it's a bit tilted because, so since earth is curved, we are not living here, we are living somewhere here. The equator for us, it looks a bit tilted. So you can see it's a bit tilted. Okay. It's tilted by 13 degrees from our meridian line. Okay. So when during this position, if you take the sun is here and earth is here, the direct sunlight will be falling towards northern sun. So it's this position in June 21st. For northern hemisphere, for sun, for us appears to be, sun is appears to be on a northern point. You can see June 21st, summer solstice. So northernmost point, it appears to be sun rising in a northernmost point. As it moves here, so this sun rising point appears to be shifted, and it, when it comes here, this position is on March 21st. During that position, this position is called equinox. And the same in opposite part, this position happened on September 24th. So these two positions called equinox point. On those 2 days, you can find the sun actually rises exact east. Rest all will be little bit towards northern side or southern side. So because the earth's tilt is away from the sun, so it's a tilt towards sun. Means earth has a tilt anyway. Tilt towards sun is zero on equinox days, because it's tilted. Sun, we have a sun here, it's tilted another direction. So during those 2 days, you can see sun rising in exact east. And when it goes here, so sunlight will be direct falling on a southern hemisphere, and it will be the northern part will get inclined light. So sun rising point appears to be towards south for us. Okay, so that's why the sun moving path in a sky is shift, appears to be tilt. It's not exactly in a exact east. So you can visualize this. If you observe the sun rising point throughout the year, you can see that in a summer solstice time, you can see sun rising at the northernmost point, and a winter solstice means December 21st, you can see southernmost point. And in a, it's not a one day change, each day there will be a small shift. When it's in a equinox in a March 21st and September 24th, it will rise in exact east. Okay, so why I'm telling this? Because of this sun's motion. So when you see, during summer solstice time, so sun will be in a northern hemisphere. So means if you towards more north. So if you draw a meridian line, sun passes like this. So this is the meridian line, sun appears to be passing like this. So the shadow will be towards south. So this sun actually passes our head above on April 24th and August 18th. That's called zero shadow. That day you won't be having any shadow there. So after April 24th, it appears to be moving like till June 21st it will go. So April 24th to June 21st, sun moving like this, the shortest shadow what you get will be towards southern. It will point in towards south. So after June 21st, then it started to come closer to here. So when during the August 18th, the sun again, it will move our head above. That time we'll have a zero shadow. And then, so it started to move towards southern part. So till December 21st, it will go here. December 21st to April 24. So where it is in this part? We have a larger period in this part because of we are in northern hemisphere. So during this part, sun will be in this part, in the southern part, in between August 18 to April 24. You can actually, it will be in the southern part, and the shortest shadow, sun since move it here, the shortest shadow will point toward north. Okay, so is there anything about 1 minute?
Equinox and solstice.
Repeat. Oh, correct. So I'll take a better example. Equinox and solstice. I'll have another video. Zero shadow day. I'll play it at 1 second. So I'll explain it 1 second. So for example, we have a video on zero shadow day. Maybe that explains you even better. Okay. So let's see a video. Okay. So this was a zero shadow day observed last year from Bangalore. Okay. So zero shadow day is a phenomena when sun is exactly overhead. So as I told, sun rising point exact east in only 2 days, and during that sun moves like this. It won't move our head above. Sun moves exactly our head above only 2 days. So when it moves exactly our overhead, so there will be won't be any shadow. Okay. Yes. See here. This is a very much. So you can see. I'll pause it here. So when it is. Yes. Yes. So when it's here, so you can see a tilt it. Yes. So this position is in a June 21st. So you can see the direct sunlight will be falling in towards northern hemisphere. So when this happens, okay. So here you can see. So in a June 21st, you can see the sun is rising towards more northern side. It's because, so its position is in here. You can see position, it's tilted towards sun. So sun appears to be rising in the northernmost side. So if you consider, if you know the exact east, so from about 23 degree from east is what the sun rising point happens. Okay, that's on June 21st. After June 21st, after June 21st, yes, after June 21st, Earth is moving in this position called equinox. This is the solstice position, this is the equinox position. So you can see Earth is tilted, but tilt is away from sun. It's not towards sun. It's neither away or neither towards sun. So the tilt with respect to sun is zero. Okay. During that time, the direct sunlight will fall on equator region. That's why for us it appears to be sun rising exact east. So after that it slowly started to move towards southernmost. So this is on December 21st. During that day, sun appears to be rising in a southernmost. This is exactly 23 degree away from the your exact north. Sun appears to be moving like this. It won't go overhead above. It appears to be moving like this. Okay. So and one thing, this is another equinox, so it's in a spring season. So again, sun from it appears to be moved here. So I'm just talking about sunrise position. So sunrise is once again happens in exact east. Okay, this is how it happens. So this is the angle of sunlight. So as angle of sunlight varies, the sun in a sky, sun rising point in a like in a near the horizon, it appears to be shifted. Zero shadow is okay. I'll explain 1 minute here. So yes. So this motion, if you see from Earth, this is how it. So you can see this is the Earth equator, and this is the motion path of sun during the summer solstice, and this is the path of sun during the winter solstice. Okay, so this can be visualized using a simple app, something called position of sun. So in that you have a something called 3D view option. From that you can actually see the how sun appears to be moving from the ground perspective. Okay, so you can see this is a sun. So as I vary the time, so you can see the sun appears to be moving. So as tilted earth moving around the sun, okay, so when it is here, it means in a summer solstice time. So sun rising point towards northern side, and we are standing here. When sun moves here, so we can see a shadow. So after day by day, it started to move towards south. So because Earth is moving here like this, so sun rising point also, or sun's path, it starts to shift towards south, southern side. So one day is exactly had to pass through our head. So that depends on latitude. We are in a 13 degree latitude. So it can after June 21st on August 18th, so it will again pass to our head. So during that day, so it will move like this. During that day, if you observe the shadow, there won't be any shadow. At the exact noon, so there will be zero shadow. There won't be any shadow, you can see. And so after 19, as again moving 19, 20, like after August, it's again start to move towards south. So it will move the southernmost on, if you go to southernmost point on December 21st, then it moves. So after, it's again start to move towards our northern side. So when it comes each day by day by day, once again in a April 24th, so again it has to pass through our head. During that day there won't be any shadow. After 24th, it will be in a southern part for us. Okay. Sorry, northern part. So when it's in northern part, a shorter shadow will be pointing towards south. So April 24th to August 18th, the shorter shadow what you get, it's pointing towards south. Anyway, after August 18th, it will be in a, sun will be in a southern part. So what you get, the shortest shadow will be pointing towards north. So you can see this video once again, and this will explain better, I think. Or you can install that app, so called Sun's Position. So position of sun, I think. 1 minute, let me check. Sunrise and sunset. That app has a 3D visualization that gives you how the sun's movement path in a max in a day sky, sun's path actually. Okay. So I'll pause it here. You can if you want to watch once again for a more detail. Right, next. Okay, so this, if you observe the sunrise, if you are able to mark, if you have a clear horizon, if you are able to mark each day the sunrise in position, you can actually see this movement. It's because of Earth's tilt, and it's a revolution motion around sun. So here, this image actually betters even more. So you observe the shadow till like in between March 24, sorry, August 18 to March 24, sorry, this is summer. Summer, during summer means during after March, April 24th to August 18, the shadow what you get. In the morning shadow, yes, it towards west, and in afternoon, around 12 o'clock, you can see a shadow will be pointing towards south. And during sunset, so again it's towards west. But the shadow is towards west. The shortest shadow will point towards south in between March, April 24th to August 18th during summer. During zero shadow day, you can see shadow will be exactly below. Okay, there won't be any shadow if you have an inclined object, something like that, there will be shadow. If you have a proper vertical object, there won't be any size variation. So you won't be able to see any shadow there. Then in a winter, you can see the sun's path, you can see it's towards the southern part, that's why the shorter shadow will point towards north. Using this experiment, so this zero shadow will explain you in between the two zero shadow days, what you get, the direction is towards south. In between like April 21st to August 18th, you'll get a shorter shadow will be towards south. So if you repeat, since today is March, sorry, May 11th, so if you do the experiment today, you get this shadow, this experiment will point towards south, not towards north. Okay? The rest all days, it will be towards north. So this is all about daytime. So how you point towards south how to point north or south. So true north, what, so in this time, like during this time, if you do the experiment, it point towards south. The opposite to that line is actually a north. That's how you can get it. So true north can be found out here now also. This is all about daytime, how you can find these directions. So what about night? How you can find the direction in night? Yes, I think you all know it's using a polaris. Okay. So how that will always show the north pole? Because our rotation axis is exactly pointing toward that point. Our rotation is aligned to that point. So that's why if you are able to find the pole star, that's exactly your true north or a celestial north. Okay, so how to find that? So we have our two constellation, pointing constellation. Using that, you can easily find out. So we have those two are actually, one is Big Dipper or a Saptarishi Mandala. Another name is called Ursa Major. Another one is Cassiopeia. So these two constellations are almost opposite to each other. At any night, if you see any one of the constellation, always will be visible. In this position, this will be set. So any one of the constellations always will be there. So there won't be any problem for to find a Polaris. So Big Dipper is or Ursa Major. There are two stars called Mirac and Dubhe. If you are able to connect and extend a line, it will go to Polaris. Don't think that Polaris is a too bright star. It's a very dull star. Okay. So it's a very dull star. It's very difficult to find it out. So using this as a major, there it's a bright star. Using that, you can actually find out the Polaris. The height of Polaris depends on our latitude. For example, for Bangalore, it's a 12.9 degree latitude. So it will be 12.9 degree above from the air horizon. Okay. So that's how it won't be exactly towards 12.9 degree above from the ground. 12.9 degree. So in that position, you can connect this line and actually you can go to the Polaris. This using Ursa Major. So if Ursa Major was set, you can see a Cassiopeia, another constellation. In a Cassiopeia, so it's a kind of a M shape. In a M shape, you can see one side is a bit elongated. Which part? Okay. So, yes. Yes, yes. Okay. Yes, in a daytime using a shadow method, you can actually point out the north. That's not a difficult part. That's easily you can find it out. Yes. So, what about nighttime? Nighttime, it's, Earth's using a polar, that's called using polarization. You know, Earth's rotation axis is actually aligned with the aligned to a polarix or a pole star. So if you are able to find the pole star, that's actual or exact north, or a true north, or a celestial north, or in another world called geographical north. So it's coincidentally aligned to our polaris. So if you are able to find the polaris, that's what the actual north. So how to find the polaris then? So since it's exactly aligned to our rotation axis, because of Earth rotation, all star patterns appears to be rotating. But polaris won't appear to be moving because it's exactly aligned to our rotation axis. For example, if you observe the fan, the center point of our fan, that's where is the rotation axis of that fan passes through. Center point, if you observe, that won't appear to be moving. All other part appears to be rotating around that point. But center point won't appear to be moving because this is aligned to our rotation axis. Similarly here, because of Earth rotation, all other stars appears to be moving because of Earth rotation. The rotation axis, which is pointing toward polaris, that won't appear to be moving. That appears to be static. Okay. So if you are able to find that polaris, then you are done. That's what your true north. Since polaris is a very dull star, it's not too bright star, it's very difficult to identify. So in order to identify that, you need you can take help of other constellation. So there are two constellations are Big Dipper and Big Dipper or called Ursa Major, or another word for Saptarishi Mandala, or another that one constellation, or you can take help of another constellation called Cassiopeia. So these two are opposite, almost opposite to each other. So if one constellation is set, another constellation will be there. Like when its Earth rotates, this appears to be set, but Cassiopeia will be there. If Cassiopeia is set, Ursa Major will be there. Any one of the constellation will be there, so you can easily point out the polaris. So using Ursa Major, there are two bright stars called Mirac and Dubhe. If you are able to connect this and extend this line, then you can get the one pretty bit bright star. It's a polaris. So this height of a polaris is dependent on your latitude. We are in Bangalore, we are in about 12.9 degree latitude. So this height will be about 12.9 degree. If you go to Arctic, the North Pole region, so you can see a polaris or head above. That's our latitude is 90 degree. There you can see a polaris or head above, and all constellations appears to be rotating around there. Okay. Since you are in Bangalore, this will be this much height. Okay. So this is using a Saptarishi Mandala or Big Dipper. Okay. Using a Cassiopeia. So Cassiopeia is kind of an M shape. So in this part, if you are able to exactly draw half angle, that will reach the polaris. So in M part, it has a one shortest angle and is a bit bigger angle. That if you are able to draw exact half angle, that will reach the polaris. So that will actually point towards polaris. So using any of this one constellation, actually you can find the polaris and you can get the true north. This polaris is aligned to a true north. So in a daytime, using a shadow experiment, you can find the true north. In a nighttime, finding polaris, you can find the true north. So that's what about today's session. Any doubt about any question, you can post on a comment. I can help you now. Yes, how do we identify the correct stars for the constellation? There are so many other stars. Yes, for a starter, you can use the app called Google Sky Map or a Stellarium. There are many apps that will, if you install that and if you just hold your mobile towards sky, they can show you all other constellation maps. So if you don't know the Ursa Major, using that you can actually find the Ursa Major and Cassiopeia, and you can find the Polaris. But I won't suggest using map, using a mobile always. So your efficiency or your finding searching skills are reducing that. So you can, I suggest that go for a maps, using that find one constellation and draw a line and extend and find another constellation. Using a graph is actually more like it will develop your skills. When is a zero shadow day? Zero shadow day is April 24th and August 18th. So now using Dogstar, we can't, it's very difficult. And Dogstar means that's a dog constellation, Sirius star. And using that, it's very difficult. It won't be available in all nights. Now it's available, it's about to set also. So now, for any other, if you have any more clarification, you can re-watch this video. This will be on YouTube. You can watch it once again. And zero shadow day also, we have a video, you can see. And during using a zero shadow day, how we can measure the circumference of Earth. That also we have it. You can understand it even more, I feel. Okay. So I want you guys to repeat the same experiment. And take a videos or a photos, everything like the graph, whatever the point of which you are drawn all. So and finding how you find the true north, the experiment video and the photos, you can mail it to us. You can mail it to bharat@younginnovators.in. So that link that I'll post it there. Or it's better we have a Facebook page, Young Innovators. We have a Facebook page and we have an Instagram account. There actually you can post your social account and you can message to us. And if it was a very good experiment, we'll promote in our page. That will be posted in our group also. Okay. Then what else? One more way is you can comment the, if you can upload to any Google Drive or anything, that and you can paste the link in a video comments. So then we'll publish in our social media. So if you have it's a very good one, we'll promote that in our public. So that's what about today's. I think I'll point up. Yes. So thank you everyone. Tomorrow's session is about projection, using a projection method, how we can find the diameter of sun. Even though we are that far, we can actually find that diameter of star. Everything can be done. So that we'll learn in next class. Thank you.